I think the reason why David Jubel and myself were successful was that we had access to the method of recording from single cells in the brain. Before that, of course, people from Heartline and Kofler had recorded from peripheral nerve, from the optic nerve. Adrian actually was the first to record from single nerve fibers in the late 20s. And then Heartline was really the pioneer in the field of vision, recording from single fibers in the frog, optic nerve. And then Stephen Kofler, who was our mentor, and then at the Hopkins at the Wilmer Institute, had used to probe single cell retinal ganglion cells. And that laid the foundation, all this work laid the foundation for the work that David and I did, make it possible for us to ask and say what happened as this information goes into the brain. What kind of, is it going to be the same story with centers around receptive fields, on center and off center, also in the lateral geniculate body and then in the cortex? Or are they, you know, we had hoped perhaps something interesting is happening. But that was just a matter of exploring what we could find. And actually, David had done some very pioneering work, David Jubel, in the awake cat. He was one of the first when he was in Jasper's lab, Herbert Jasper at Montreal, and then at the Walter Reed. He developed a method for mounting a holder of electrodes on the cat's head, and he could record from single cells in a wide awake cat. And he found that cells were very specific in direction. Some cells responded to one direction of movement and others to other direction of movement. But it was a very difficult analysis to do because the cat's head was moving, the eyes were moving, and it became clear from his work that this was something potentially very interesting. And I actually heard about the work the first time at a conference at the Atlantic City. And the Federation, during this time, there was a so-called Federation meeting every spring held in Atlantic City. And so in the spring of, I think it was probably in 57, David presented this work. And it sounded very intriguing. So the opportunity came and David was going to come to work with Werner Mancaster, but that, for space reasons, didn't work out, so he came to join the Kofler lab where I was. And so we then decided that we should first, before we started to work on awake animals, we should look at anesthetized animals, where we could stabilize the eyes and the heads and really map the receptive fields of single cells, both in the lateral geniculate body and then in the cortex, which we did. And there was always early on a debate where the work that David Jubel and I described in the anesthetized animal perhaps had nothing to do with the way the visual system worked in the awake animal. So, but that actually was a scientist by the name of Robert Wirtz, who later on did record actually from the primary visual cortex in the monkey, in awake monkeys, and showed that indeed cells in the monkey primary visual cortex, striate cortex, had the same properties as cells in the awake animal as in the sleeping animal. But that was a debate, and the main reason for using an anesthetized animal is, as I said, you can have these receptive fields are very small, and in order to do a proper map of the response properties of a cell, you needed to have the eyes need to be stabilized. And the easiest way of stabilizing the eye is to anesthetize the animal and paralyze it so the eyes cannot move. So that's the process we used for 20 years. The two main findings were, on the one hand, that cells in the primary visual cortex were sensitive to orientation of contours. And they differed from retinal ganglion cells and cells in the lateral geniculate body that provide the input to the visual cortex. They don't care about the orientation of contour. They respond very well to the contour, but the orientation of the contour is of no consequences. Whereas for cells in the primary visual cortex, they care. They may respond to an orientation at 2 o'clock, so let's say, but not at 12 o'clock. So this was a new feature that was created by specific wiring of the input. That was a very surprise. Nobody expected it. We certainly didn't expect it. And there was, and it took probably 10 years before people really accepted it. There was a very famous visual physiologist by the name of William Rushton. Most young people today don't know who that was, but during the 50s and 60s and 70s, he was one of the leaders in vision. He was a psychophysicist as well, as he did some very interesting measurement of visual pigment in the alive eye. And I gave a talk in Tallahassee, Florida, at one point, and William Rushton was there as a visiting professor. He liked to leave England. It was in the cold, in the winter time, and he liked to go there to get out of the British climate. So at that time, I gave a talk and I showed the film where we actually had recorded the response properties of cells in the visual cortex. So he came up to me afterward and he said, "Now, Torsten, I believe you." And that was 1969. It was 10 years after we had first published the paper in Journal of Physiology, which is a British journal. But how do you deconstruct it? And how do you then put it together into an image that you perceive? Well, that's a question. So that's why some people have said that we broke the code, how information from the eye is transported and then put together. We still don't know most of it. This was just a first glimpse into the complexity of the mechanism behind the neural basis of perception. You know, we are all interested to understand neural basis of perception, and we have a few straws to build that image, but we don't have a complete understanding by any means of neural basis of perception. But it's just the beginning, and future decades will perhaps tell us bit by bit more and more about the process. But it's a complex issue. The key questions that have been answered first is that there are specificity in terms of contour orientation. There is a binocular interaction. How many cells in the cortex respond both to the left eye and the right eye, and they provide the mechanism of fusing images from the two eyes, which is, you know, one. We also have learned, Jack Pettigrew were the first to show it, and other labs, including our own, subsequently showed that we have cells responding to depth, so so-called disparities, so receptive field. Instead of making possible for images to fuse, it made possible for images to fuse at different distances, in front or behind the point of fixation. This provides our information about depth, and so these are very basic issues how we analyze images, but it doesn't tell us anything how I recognize more complex objects, how a given object is put together so we perceive it in its shape and color and depth, you know, all these things together. And that's how the building blocks are put together, we don't know. We know perhaps something about the building blocks, but we don't know how the thing is put together. You have to go to the infratemporal lobe, then people describe their cells, they're responding to faces. And now, how does that happen? How do you get a cell suddenly made up somehow through some neural connection to respond to a face? Nobody has shown how this is put together. You know, how do you go from a cell in V1 responding to orientation of a contour to a cell in the infratemporal lobe responding to a face? This is what you want to know. See, this is what I like to know, is how the how you input to a given area and how it is processed and how the output looks. And this has to be done from V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, and so on, infratemporal loops. No one really knows the input to the infratemporal loop, what the input looks like, and how that is processed to, so that we can get cells responding to a phase. You could probe intermediate stages and see how cells respond there, and in which way they contribute to the input to the infratemporal lobe, which in turn, would. So, you know, we have the model of a face with two eyes and a nose and a mouth and the ears. That's one thing, that cell. But then is your face looks different from your colleagues' faces here, and how do we? Where does this happen and how does it happen? You know, this is really a highly sophisticated kind of processing that has to occur in order for this to happen. And these are the kind of interesting problems that why we envision like to understand. Not only this, so that's why I'm saying we are still at a very primitive level of understanding of the process. We still are collecting flowers as if, you know, describing this here and there, but we don't know how the whole thing is put together. This is a challenge for the future young scientist. I think the linkage is probably best described in the monkey between 17 and 18, V1 and V2, in terms of because there it had been possible to in V2 to see different type of columns anatomically, pale and dark columns and intermediate columns. And it had been shown that there are binocular cells in one kind of regions, anatomical region, and color cells in another kind of region, and orientation-specific cell in this third region. So that has been very helpful to do here combined anatomy with the physiology. And there have been many labs involved in that. And I don't think that Nobel Wiesel and subsequent work should be given undue credit there. There have been many people involved. But it does seem that in the binocular region that cells, as I described before, cells responding neither to the left eye or to the right eye, only to a response a stimulus that is either in front or behind the point of fixation, what we call depth cells, we find them very characteristically in V2. And Charles Gilbert and myself and Dan So, who was a graduate student and then a postdoc, showed that they are arranged in a columnar fashion in V2. So that whole organization is a very beautiful, again, very crystallized or beautifully organized kind of set of columns in V2 for depth vision, another for color, and a third region, presumably to analyze orientation contours. And the specificity of that region is relative to what's in difference between those cells from those in V1 is not clear to me, at least. It may be clear to somebody else, but they have very similar properties. You have to think about that. The process here seemed to be that different features in the visual stimulus are segregated out. So depth, orientation, color, and it's processed as if separate, by separate pathways. And this you start to see already in particularly, you don't see so much of that clearly in the retina or in the lateral geniculate body, even if it's a hint there, but in the primary visual cortex you clearly have in the columnar organization and in the blobs that David Jubel and others have recorded from. And this is still more so in the V2, where you see this, as I described, the different regions that you can see anatomically clearly different. So, and as you go higher to higher region, there are some, like MT, people think primarily it has to do with movement. And V3, Zeki thought that's particularly important for color, and so on. So there seemed as if in the processing machinery you have different regions specializing for certain feature in the visual stimulus. And then this is being processed, and then put together. How it's put together and that whole process is still not well understood. New methods are essential for making new discoveries, and if you look at the history of science, it's not that we are smarter today than they were 100 years ago or 50 or 10 years ago. It's just that we have tools available to us who were not available to the scientists at earlier ages. So I'm very much in favor of developing new methods. Actually, through the McKnight Foundation, we now have a program specifically to stimulate scientists to develop new methods, and they receive $100,000 a year for 2 years in order to try to develop a method in neuroscience. And we were fortunate in the sense that taking advantage of methods, microelectrode. David actually was very important. David Jubel developed a tungsten electrode, which we used, still are used. Many laboratories all over the world are using that electrode to record extracellularly from cells. And then we have the Nauta stain that had been very important to trace pathways in the brain, and that was then supplemented with the autoradiography, where you could inject radioactive amino acid, titrated usually, and then they synthesized the peptides and then transported. So we used that from injecting the eye. We could show the pathway through the lateral cingulate cortex through the lateral cingulate body to the visual cortex. There are now a number of other methods that in tracing pathways from viruses to herpes virus had been used, attenuated herpes virus for following and pathways. And there are other dyes now, antigrade and retrograde dyes that are available for tracing pathways, which we have used. So another method that have been very useful is the visual optic method. In my lab, I had Amiram Greenwald, who is now at the Weizmann Institute in Israel. He was instrumental to develop an optical method to visualize optic orientation columns and ocular dominance columns. And he also now has a very nice method where he can stain the cortex and actually see in real time the activity of the cortex. Again, you're dealing here with hundreds of thousands of cells, not individual cells, but you can see ensembles of cells and see what they have in common and get the gross architecture of the cortex in columnar organizations visualized. And of course now, recent years, the functional NMR has become very important for the science, not only in the clinic, but also in experimental work. These various methods will bring a new aspect to our understanding of the brain. A lot of the functional imaging using functional NMR or PET have been localization of functions more than understanding how the process of the processing and the brain works. But still, these are, you know, any method that shed new light on some aspect of brain function is useful, and we should combine various techniques, various skills, various scientists' ideas, and so on. Then actually, people are more and more using more than one electrode. They use several electrodes, there are some laboratories you have devices you can buy now that have 4 to 8 electrodes that you can record, and you insert that into the cortex. You can move each electrode separately and then isolate several cells, and then what people do, they see, do this when you stimulate then the cortex by some sensory stimulus, you then see if the cells respond to the same thing or different things. And you can then, by a method called cross correlation, you can then very effectively see if these cells share an input, if they talk to each other, and in which way they interact, positively or negatively. So it's a very powerful method. I mean, as I said before, you like to understand the neural basis of perception, because in order to, you have to know something about perception also in addition to knowing about the neuronal basis. And I think we collaborated, Charles Gilbert and I collaborated with Gerald Westheimer, who is he's a psychophysicist, and we have a very intimate collaboration with him in terms of the physiology behind the perceptual phenomena, like our ability to discriminate orientation and many things of that. The next step that people now are very interested is in to relate cognition to the neural substrate. And so there are a lot of interesting work here, and both with imaging and also with single cell work. And there's some very good laboratories doing that. It's a more challenging question in a sense. And but some progress have been made, and I think it's essential. For myself, I have been sort of stuck as if in V1 because it's an area that I know well, and there are still many unsolved problems that. And I would like to be able to go and do similar analysis in other higher visual areas, but that hasn't happened, and it will not happen by myself. There may be other young scientists who will meet that sort of challenge to try to understand. But ultimately, we all want to understand how we get to the point of having a perceived image, cognition of objects and realize, recognize things. So that's. I think the methods we talked about that before. Maybe just as an aside, I could, there's some excitement in the field of in all of field of biology, is because it's now possible to analyze the brain in different ways. One is new optics. So there's the two-photon microscopy, for example, that make it possible for you to look at single cells, not only in slices of brain, but actually in vivo, in the brain. So that's one area that now is very intensively looked at, and it's. The other area is DNA technology. There's famous DNA chips, and now people are in the process of making custom make their DNA chips so that they can look at different areas of the brain to see at which genes are turned on under certain various conditions. So that's a new way of analyzing brain function that still is not known well, but will be a very powerful, some of us believe, powerful way of also analyzing brain function. And so future generations that will be part of the, like imaging or single cell recordings, and imaging of columns will be used. In some sense, I share the point of view that Francis Crick, he told me some years ago that, Torsten, you are wasting your time working on primates because you have to work on the mouse, because genetics is going to be really what's making the difference. So he made a very valid point that if you're going to understand brain functions and development of the brain, genetics is going to be an integral part of that part of our understanding. So I think the possibility now, because of the development of the DNA chips, is that you probably can also do the genetics as if in the monkey, not in the way that you create mutations and look at the difference between different animals, and knockouts and knock-ins that you can do in the mouse, but you can use genetics in a way that you can
see on the various stimulus conditions which genes are turned on, so you can make custom make your chips in such a way that you can read out the genes activated on the various conditions. And this has opened up a whole new way of studying complex systems. And so there are several labs, including our own, and Charles Giblet particularly, interested in developing the technology and the methodology to do this is interesting way. And but you know, again, as we came back to the importance of methods, and we need obviously new method. The other method that is of great interest now that leads to new opening doors, as if it's a two-photon microscopy that you can look not only at brain slices, but you can actually also use it to look at cells, individual cells in a living brain. And there are now a number of specific dyes or molecules to recognize the cell if it's activated or not. So in the future, you can probably be able to scan the brain and see which cells are being activated, not by recording impulse activity, but just looking at which genes are turned on. Certain. So it's still it's for a young person, you know, with training good training in molecular biology and interested in complex system, there are possibilities now opening up that we didn't have certainly. In the old days. So probably, I think, again, even if new method, you still have to be very careful in choosing a problem that is good. And I've met under my years people who have learned a technique into, for example, clone a certain gene and say, now I have cloned the gene, what am I going to do now? You know, so they ask you. And so it seems to me that too many people are focusing on technical things and learn technique, but instead of looking at the problem first and see, this is a problem, how do I solve it, and what methods are necessary. Maybe I need to develop a new method in order to solve this problem, but then you are focused on the problem, not on the technique. And so many people become technicians in a way, that they're thinking more about technical things they can do with that, rather than focusing the research on a problem that they want to solve. And I think that's a weakness in the way we train our scientists. We don't leave them alone. They have to learn to think. They have to think about problems and talk about more the issues of interest rather than technical aspects. One other thing you can say in general about research today in biology is that the methodology is so similar in different areas. If you're a cell biologist, molecular biologist, if you're interested in the liver or if you're interested in the brain, a lot of the methods in terms of the cellular molecular basis and genetic basis of cell behavior are similar. So there is a similarity in terms of unification in a way that some of us feel that nowadays you should only have in medical school, the division of medical science, and forget about departments, because of the unification of the basic way of looking at biological problems and biomedical problems. At the same time, the brain is very different from the liver. My colleague David Jubel used to emphasize that difference. And because you have the multiplicity of different cell types, you have all these billions of cells with different interconnections, and so that problem is very specific in terms of the connected systems operation. The receptor, the ligand binding to receptors, are not all that different from all cells have receptors. You know, if the immune cell has a receptor, they respond to things. A nerve cell has a receptor, they respond. So there are a lot of similar problems. Transduction, for example, is going to be similar in many ways in the nerve cell as any other cell in the body. So there are, depending on the problem you're asking, you have this similarity in general approaches. So the advances, Richard Axel, for example, came out of molecular biology and cell biology. He's not a nervous system person to start with. He then, a student of his, became interested in olfaction and developed the, using molecular techniques, developed this breakthrough in a way in olfaction. And I think, made a very important contribution there, using classical method in molecular biology. And so that's different, but the systems problems are different, you see, because here you're talking about the interconnections, and here are the physiologists and anatomists, and also now more and more the bioinformatics people come into trying to, and the computer science comes in, because you have a complexity here in terms of system organization that our mind cannot really deal with on a numeric level. So where you have a whole different set of problems to deal with than you have in the basic cell molecular biology dealing with the nervous system. So it's a, I don't mean to say that the systems people should be ignorant about molecular and cell biology, because the recent discovery, as I mentioned, about the DNA chips means that, you know, here suddenly the systems people wake up and say, oh, this is interesting. We can use this perhaps to understand more complex system organization. And people in memory and so on, people like Eric Kendall and Tonagawa, etc., they are now becoming more and more interested in systems and in studying the mouse, doing knock-in and knockouts, and learning about a more complex system using basic molecular biological techniques. But now have to also deal with the complexity of study behavior. What are the consequences? What is the phenotype of this kind of manipulations, and you have to suddenly, you will find that the classical physiology to be able to record the classical anatomy is going to be important for the molecular biologist. So that field that sort of was downgraded in importance in terms of appointment to new positions at universities, suddenly you will find, my prediction is that you will find that these people with a background in understanding of cellular physiology and will be more, and anatomy will be more sought after than has been the case in the last decade. Shortly after we came to Harvard, actually in 59, probably early 60s, that we felt we knew enough about the primary visual cortex, that we could ask the question how this came about. That is, were animals born with this, all these ocular dominance columns and orientation columns and movement sensitivity, etc.? Or was it something that the cortex learned as if by visual stimulation? So that was an interest now that we asked, and that was probably part based on our clinical experience. We know from that children born with cataracts, that even when they were operated, and they usually tend to be operated when they were 5 or so years of age, that even if they got proper refractions, proper glasses, etc., they never really learned to see well. So David and I thought that since we now knew that cells in the cortex, what kind of features they had, by recording from a newborn animal, we should be able to tell the cells at birth have same properties later in life. And we could show that indeed was the case. It was particularly striking in the monkey, where at birth, you know, the monkey is ready to use its eye, whereas we also worked in the cat. Kittens are born with the eyelids closed until they are 12 days to 2 weeks old. And when they open their eyes, the
cells in the visual cortex are still very sluggish. And there was some controversy in the field for some time, because in some we reported that also in the cat you could, without no vision early in life, you have cells were sensitive to orientation of contours, whereas other laboratories reported that it was not the case. And that's then, of course, the monkey sorted this out, because it was very crisp, clear responses in the monkey, and because the monkey at birth is very alert, and the eyes are open. So I think that controversy is sort of more history than a problem in the field. So we are born with a whole set of, certainly primates are, with a whole set of cells in the visual cortex ready to respond to the outside world. And so why is it so, if you're born with a cataract, the children couldn't see well? And so that's why we did the experiment. We said, first we thought we could raise animals in the dark, but we had just moved to Harvard and we didn't have enough facilities to do that. So we got this brilliant idea to just close the lid on one eye. It's a very easy operation to do. You trim the lids and suture them together. It's the same procedure that ophthalmologists use when they, in patients sometimes, to prevent the cornea from drying out. So with this procedure, we could do that at birth and then leave the animal for various lengths of times. And then we could separate the lids and then study the animals, if we could see with that eye when we opened it. And we could record from cells in the retina, from the lateral geniculate body, and in the cortex, and see, you know, how the cells respond. And we, in this experiment, that's what we could demonstrate, that in fact, the cells in the eye, the retinal ganglion cells, and the lateral geniculate cell responded as in the normal case. So there was input to the visual cortex is perfectly normal. But when we recorded from cells in the visual cortex, it was very hard for us to find any cells responding to the eye that had been covered by the sutured lid. And that was a great surprise. Now what happened, you could ask, did these cells who didn't receive input from that eye, did they die? Or what had happened? And that's how the experiment that where anatomy sort of came to help, because that was when we used a method of autoradiography. We injected radioactive amino acid into triturated proline into one eye, and then this is synthesized with peptide taken up by retinal ganglion cells and then transported in to the lateral geniculate body. And also through across to the next cell, to the geniculate cell, which then in turn send the peptide up to the visual cortex. The idea for this experiment came through Bernice Garfstein here at Cornell Medical School, who had shown in a rat that if you inject radioactive proline into the eye, that she radioactively could detect activity in the cortex. And she suggested perhaps it had gone through transsynaptically through the cortex. And we thought, if we give a big enough dose, maybe we can see it in the microscope. So we did that, and we indeed did discover that ocular dominance columns, that is a projection from the lateral geniculate to layer 4, as I described before, it's a very half a millimeter wide region in layer 4 receiving input from one eye, and you go from column to column, from left eye to right eye, from left eye to right eye, in the normal. In this case, when we injected the normal eye and waited for the transport of the radioactive material to the cortex, we found that the normal eye now had spread. So in layer 4, there was the input from from the geniculate from the open eye had spread out and now taken over the region normally innervated by the eye that was closed. We could actually show in the experiment at birth, the two in the monkey were segregated, and later on, when we deprived one eye, the normal eye, the open eye, had spread out and taken over territories that normally belonged to the other eye. And that's why we sort of conceived the concept of competition between the two eyes in terms of synaptic space, so that if you favor one eye by closing the other eye, then it loses out as if, and the normal eye takes over territories that belongs to the other eye. And so the reason why there were very few cells in the visual cortex, the primary cortex, responding to the eye that had been covered was that cells in layer 4 no longer responded to that eye, and the cells instead responding to the open eye. So it was not a cell death, it was just a territorial expansion of the input from the normal eye that then made it. So therefore, you know, in the child would be blind on that eye. The monkey was blind on that eye. So this is what came as a big surprise, that actually the entire wiring of the brain would change just by this very simple procedure preventing sensory input from one source. And that sort of changed one's way of looking at interaction between different inputs. That you have this within the brain, probably in other systems too, this competition between input. So in higher areas, when you have audition and vision coming together, this again is going to be an interaction between the two sensory systems that will determine the relative importance of one over the other for the individual. So if you could imagine that if you are not being stimulated, let's say, by music or sounds of different sort, that will be less important, less of a significant stimulus for you than would have been the case if you had been exposed to a more interesting auditory environment early in life. So these are things we really don't know well, but the best we know, the example I like to give is in language, with the work that Peter Amos did at Brown University. He showed that babies, when they are 6 months to 12 months of age, if you test them for their ability to discriminate phonemes, ba, bu, bi, etc., he found that at that age, babies have a very broad register in terms of discrimination. He used a very simple method of sucking the baby. If the baby recognized a phoneme, he would suck. If he didn't, the difference between two phonemes, he would suck. And he showed that later in life, when the baby was, let's say, 1.5 to 2 years old and tested, this was the time when they begin to learn a language. So if they lived in an English-speaking environment, they did very well with phonemes present in the English language. But if they grew up in the Japanese environment, they had lost some phonemes that is present in the English language but not present in the Japanese. So that's the reason why Japanese can't hear an R, is that they can hear an R at birth, but because they are not exposed to the sound of R, they lose this ability to discriminate between and to hear the sound. So even I know friends, Japanese friends here, they can, if they see a word written with an R in, they can say an R, but if it's a new word with an R in, they can't hear it. They can't hear the R. So, and I think this is probably true for many of our higher functions, that we have perhaps functions that could have been developed if we had been in a richer environment than now is the case. I look upon it as one way through which the brain can model itself to the environment. I mean, you need to have a certain amount of flexibility in the wiring diagram, because a certain set of connections are made in utero, so that when you are born, the brain can functioning. But then during the first month or year of life, maybe all through puberty, there are periods, critical periods, during which stimuli of various kinds are important in order for these connections to be fully defined and refined. And that's why you need to have this flexibility, or some people have said, use the word plasticity, to shape the brain in a way that it will function optimally in the environment in which you happen to be born. I mean, it's a beautiful, I think, example of the positive things. Now, the danger of that flexibility or plasticity is that if you have some problem, like if you have a lid, sources of the lid, so you don't, that this can lead to serious defects. But the positive aspect should be emphasized, because this is a beautiful way for a brain to shape itself according to the environment in which you live. And also, you know, for us to, as educators, to look upon our children as beautiful instruments to develop new potential in terms of what they can learn and understand. And see. So, and I think one also have to think about, as even us as adults have also a certain amount of flexibility. You can show, and Mersenic experiments are very interesting. Mersenic at UCSF has done a very beautiful experiment. He's been pioneering the area, studying changes in the cortex, in particular in the somatosensory system, where if he have a monkey and he stimulate one finger and not the others, so this finger has a much larger area of cortical representation than the other fingers have, and expanded its area very much like the ocular dominance column. So, and this happened in the adult, and these are connections probably already there, because it can happen very quickly, but because of the interaction in normal, there's a steady state when all fingers are active and they each keep their emphasis, but if you favor one over the other, then there is a change. So this is very important for you. If you're going to be a pianist, or if you're trying to learn a new skill, you need to have this sort of flexibility in the neural connections. And we know also that you actually can form new connections, at least in the adult as well, with time. So there are probably several things to be to keep in mind. The Mersenic experiments are showing the plasticity in the system, but if you look at our ability to learn new, as we talked about, new faces, recognize faces, to learn new languages, to anything else we can learn, must mean that we can form new neural connections. So the sort of neural plasticity is something we have all through life. Mersenic experiment shows that you can very rapidly bring in new connections that may be there but is not apparent until you have a certain situation. So if we have Charles Gilbert and I, we made lesions in the eye, and we showed that, then looking at cells in the cortex, we showed that cells that normally do not respond to these horizontal connections, after some time of recovery, as if there had been a small stroke, you could say, after some time, these connections start to drive the cells. So there is even a lot of the work that Mersenic did, he uncovered connections already there by these procedures. So there are a lot of connections established in the nervous system that we are not using as main signal pathways, but may be uncovered under certain connections. So if you have a stroke, then connections that otherwise may not be very important now suddenly gain importance and can reestablish their, as if strengthen their synaptic connections and become effective. So that's one way, without having necessarily to propose that new nerves are growing out to innervate new areas. And
That's an important difference, and we has always been people have been struck by the observation that you can make a lesion, and initially the animal cannot perform the functions that it's supposed to do, but just a few days later it regains it and can again function. So some alternate pathway is clearly there to be used under such circumstances. So that's a sort of a, I mean, people like to call this redundancy, but in terms of connections, but I don't think that's a way to think about it. I think you should think about it as ways of in a traffic thing. You have main roads and you have you have also supporting roads. So if you are in the military, for example, you know how important it is to have additional routes to bring forward supplies, not only the main highways. And so you can look upon this system in a way, very built in a way to assure success.
There's no particular events differ in the developing brain from the adult brain. The only difference is that, as we discussed before, that there is more flexibility in forming new connections and interrupting connections, and change the wiring, which is provided through innate connections. So you have a system built through genetic mechanism, and that then can be modified depending on the usage. And the extent of that modification will vary depending on the situation. That is, if you cover an eye, as we discussed, then that will lead to very dramatic changes. But we also know that if a child is cross-eyed, for example, that this will lead specifically to the interruption of the connection from the two eyes. So the cells in the cortex will now respond either to one eye or to the other, but not to both eyes. And you know, some children become amblyopic, that is, become even with when they are cross-eyed, they may have very poor vision in one eye and good vision in the other. And if you look at the cortex, and try to stimulate the weak eye, you find that there are fewer cells now driven by that eye, as if this eye had been covered. And how that mechanism occurs, David Jubel and I thought about it again in terms of competition, but how this, why it should change this way, why some kids become alternate, that is, have good vision in both eyes but can't fuse images, and other kids get one weak eye and one strong eye. Still not being able to fuse, but that is unclear. And I tried to actually raise monkeys to see if I could create an amblyopia in one eye, that is, and create one strong eye and one weak eye. But all our monkeys became alternator, that is, they have good vision in both eyes but couldn't fuse. So the cells become completely monocular, either driven by the left eye or right eye. And it was one monkey seemed to have a weaker eye than the other, but I was worried about that could have been some other reason for that than just strabismus. So. But that's to me it's been a very interesting question, try to come to grips with that, because clinically it's important. Because you want to prevent children from losing sight in one eye, and you also want to restore binocular vision in kids. And we know in the critical period, if you don't correct a kid with a cross-eyed or wall-eyed within the first year, it's very difficult to restore binocular functions. That is, to restore the connections so that cortical cells respond, a given cortical cell respond to both the left and the right eye. So. This is a field I think very interesting, that one with better method to correct for eyes, the deviation of the eyes, you could say vision in many kids. As you know, they're now using botulinus toxin, which is a very, very strong toxin, if you, as you know, can kill you, but by injecting very small
doses of this toxin into the eye muscle of one of the eye that pull the eye to one direction, you weaken that muscle and you can straighten out the eye. And this is now a method used, and it's approved by FDA and so on. So it has been a very elegant way of trying to restore function early in kids. Because once you if you can restore it before you have lost all your binocular cells, then the eyes may lock in and then work together. If you have no binocular cells, there is nothing that makes it possible for the two eyes to lock in and work together. So that's sort of it's an interesting, beautiful way of trying to help kids. You know, here you come into a certain extent to philosophy, the discussion we had about the role of stimulation early in life, that is, if you are not stimulated one eye by covering it, then that can lead to malfunction. And similarly with this language development, how important it is and how you can modify the ability of the subject to respond to sounds, phonemes, depending on your experience in terms of languages. So, and I think my tendency is to look upon that from a broader perspective and say that Head Start program, for example, that are, you know, usually start when the children are 3 or 4 years old, should actually start very early at birth, in a certain sense. So if you're really going to provide an environment, optimal environment for a child to develop all its position, all its capabilities, one should provide a rich environment from the beginning. And the earlier you do it, the better, because there is a critical period in life, and if the child can be exposed during that period, it's very important. The Chinese culture, you know, is such that you should spend a lot of time and effort and love and attention to the children during the first 4 years of life. After that, it's less important. And so they, you know, it's an old tradition. They knew that this is a critical period to some extent for many of the aspect of our what should we say, brain function or personalities, our ability to respond to the outside world. So my point is really, when I talk about this issue of nature and nurture, in part to nullify the disastrous effect of the bell curve book, which I thought by Murphy and Hornstein, who was a bestseller list and had this emphasis on genetics, that some races are inferior genetically and therefore cannot compete. That whole issue has no real, in my view, basis, scientific basis. And we do have in this particular system, not the only one, there are other systems, but since that's what I worked on, vision is to show very clearly that genetically we are endowed with certain capabilities. And if these capabilities are fully used, you can develop the system well. If they are not, if you are deprived, in this terms of visually deprived, the system does not function well and doesn't develop fully. And you actually can get changes in the wiring of the brain. So when you look in Romania on abandoned children, for example, who lie in a crib, are fed 3 times a day, but otherwise just lie staring on the ceiling, these kids do not develop normally because of their state of deprivation, not only in stimuli, sensory stimuli, but also in terms of attention, love, you know, the kind of stimuli a child needs for normal development. So these are issues I think are important for people in politics, in forming of programs, should be aware about. There is a reality here that a biological reality that should be met.